partir de 20h55 sur Europe2 TV, la chaîne de la musique.
I was 17, 18, and 19, you know, we were different, we were going to be different, and that's all.
I remember the days they were just signing bands left and right. Record companies were hungry to grab up anything that had potential. We didn't try to be conventional.
It was visually, it was like, what?
That was today to be a major attraction.
To actually be able just to be so free without convention and get in the crowd and actually get right in people's faces and stuff. I mean, that's a trip. And they were really good women types.
But I love it.
We were a little bit out of sync with the world, or as he said, perhaps ahead of our time.
If I look back at it now, it was inevitable.
Because I had so many friends in Detroit that practically begged me, you know, oh, can we ever hear you guys again? Oh, we want it so bad, so bad.
There was unfinished business here. We decided we were going to have a group around the spring of 67. Mm-hmm. And it took us a full year until the spring of 68 until we got on a stage in front of people. Okay. During that whole year, the thing really spiraled and changed a great deal. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the thing just wouldn't get off the ground at all, and you'd end up like, it'd be 3 a.m, and we'd be sitting around, and I'd be saying, well, maybe I'll try, you know, I've heard I heard electroshock, remember what I was? I heard electroshock puts you in another state where you're creative. So I took my old train set. You know,
I remember that.
Yeah, you know, so sometimes things didn't work. We were way out there.
But I think it was Jim's idea from the very beginning that we were different, we were going to be different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's all.
As soon as we got the record deal, I just went, oh, shoot, we better have some fucking songs. And he came up pretty near after that with the two bedrock riffs. And that was the No Fun riff, which I believe he had first. I'm not sure about that. And then he had, or may have been the other way around, he came up with the I Wanna Be Your Dog riff. And over time, as I remember it, we developed those into songs.
Mm-hmm.
It took a few months. But first, we just go out and play the riff over and over. I mean, that's what we did. And basically, by the time we worked at it, trying to songwriting, because we had a record deal. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to have songs first. But
we signed with the Jams.
Yeah, it started as the first two chords. Like most Stooges songs, we were stoned on our smoke and jamming, and Ron came up with the two chords over and over, which is just this one. Just those two back and forth. I used Johnny Cash's I'll Walk the Line as a model for this. If you could actually hear it, if you listen to I Walk the Line, you got, I'll keep a close walk on this. Let's see, wait. Wait a minute.
Yep. I keep a close watch on this heart of mine. Boom, boom. I keep my eyes wide open all the time. I keep the ends out for the eyes that bind, because you're mine. I walk a line.
So we used that structure.
Right. And we were teenagers.
Yeah.
I was 17, 18, and 19, you know, we were
I was
kids.
Older. I was, by that time, I was 21, but we were young.
It was a good time because of, they were just signing bands left and right. Music was new, the English invasion, everything was popping. I remember the days when you could turn on the radio and you would like just about every song on the radio. So everyone was, record companies were hungry to grab up anything that had potential. So that part was good. But then as the worm turns, we were a little bit out of sync with the world, or as he said, perhaps ahead of our time.
Yeah, the reason I say ahead of our times is because the original band, the way we played, the songs, the music, if that was today, it'd be a major attraction.
Happy son of a bitch, we got that logo out of you, so fuck you. He hated us. He got us dropped from the company later. His name is Bill Harvey.
So he was someone from Elektra?
Yes, the general manager of Elektra was also the art director.
I didn't know that.
Yes.
He did.
And he said, you need a logo. What you need is a logo. And you know,
good.
We got it. That's the best thing we got out of that company, because the deal is just ridiculous. The royalty is like, you need a microscope, you know. It was also his job. I went into the, they wanted us to play four nights in a club in New York to promote a new album once, and I had never played four nights in a row, so I decided that to do that, I was going to have at least a quarter ounce of cocaine, and I didn't have any money, so I went into the company and I asked for a meeting with the general manager, and I said, here's the deal, and I can't possibly do this, you gotta give me the money for this cocaine, and he did it. But from that time on, he was gonna get us out of there, so. I think I have some sort of a disease in my tendons. Yeah, they call it Osgood Schlatter's disease.
I've heard of that.
Yeah, and apparently I was very limber, and that was part of it. And then the other part was I was always a spaz in school, and I couldn't dance with girls. I was too shy, and I couldn't dance to music, so I always wanted to move around. Like, I saw black people dance, I want to be like them. I want to have fun dancing too. So I did my own thing.
Well, it's 1969, okay.
Who names themselves fucking Iggy?
It's like you name your pet monkey.
There's something about that name. It just
another year.
pisses people off or makes them go, and I mean, back in the day, I mean, I can't tell you, in the 60s in the USA, very martial, you know, military intolerance.
Yeah.
Ultra macho place, and you know, I'd walk in and maybe somebody'd say, "Hi, Iggy," and some big,
yeah.
Iggy, what the hell?
Yeah.
I gotta beat him up right now, you know. God damn, and you know, it's just like, ooh, it made some people laugh, it made some people sneer. Revulsion, like there were ants crawling up their body. And most people just got really pissed off.
Yeah, but
I don't know why.
Yeah.
Now it's just like Iggy, hey Iggy,
it's like hey Iggy, it's like
but
hey,
it wasn't
John.
It wasn't like that.
Mm.
You know,
it was
you did heavy shit.
It really,
it was even hard for me.
It's amazing that people would think that it's just a name,
but
it really would piss me off.
The first time I ever had sex with a girl, and she started going. But yeah, now I love it.
First record was finished, it's on the road to promote that record. So we grew up on the stage. So we play the first record, and any little chance we had a break, we'd come up and test drive a new song. So next break, test drive, keep that song, tune it up, test drive another song. So naturally, the whole album was created a funhouse on little breaks from being on the road, and eventually, that was what was being played. And you can see the progression of the players getting better, a little more confident, the growth in the music, as we learn everything in front of the people. On stage is how I learned to play.
I never thought about this before. It occurs to me that the sound of Funhouse has a lot to do with the way we sounded before we made that first album. You know,
yeah,
it has.
More.
I never thought of that, but it has a lot of those. If you had, for instance, if you had gone to hear us at one of those early gigs, one of the riffs that he was playing would be like, you know, it was, and it was very. Again, very slinky winky, and nothing to. And then he was playing. It was very tribal beat to that. And there were the. We didn't have a sax yet, so I was trying to do that with the vacuum cleaner. Yeah, I used a vacuum cleaner. Going out live all the time too. You begin to think about. You feel the psychic demands of an audience, unspoken. You think. If I could do such and such, I bet that would really be, you know. So because of that, it's a kind of crucible. Pre-Christian.
Yes.
Pre-Christian.
Yeah, pagan.
I would say so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd say that's fair. That's fair.
I mean, it's pretty amazing for someone. I mean, for me, I knew him, and I always thought he was a little off, but pretty conservative, actually. And then the first time playing to see what he did, it's like, whoa, that's interesting. Mm-hmm. So I imagine yourself getting up there with musicians with limited capabilities that are creating this chaos, and what are you gonna do? So I've often thought it must have been really fun to do that stuff, to actually be able just to be so free without convention and get in the crowd and actually get right in people's faces and stuff. I mean, that's a trip. Not many people are gonna do that. Just get right in a big crowd of people, let them manhandle you and vice versa, and right in their faces, because I know that a few times when he's upset people in the crowd and they're waiting in ambush after the show, I'm the one that gets popped. He scoots, he walks right through it, like a little lizard go, and then I'm coming around, bam. And then you really do see stars. Starts with a phone call. It was a phone call from Jim saying, well, we've auditioned 150 bass players and drummers, so we can't find anybody good enough. So how much would you and your brother like to come over and play with you be playing bass? So for me, it was a chance to get out of Dodge and get back in the shit. So that's what I really like about it. And for me, it's good memories. The only thing that would be bad was the miserable ending. And the same thing, once again, no manager, no this, no that. And we were just constantly on the road. I mean, for no pay, you get $15 a day per diem, that was it. And then every night I would literally just take off my clothes and almost stand my costume in the corner, because they're not being cleaned. And we'll just take these off and stand these pants and throw those socks. It's like a suit of armor standing in the corner or something. But all in all, especially looking back on it, was some rugged times, but a lot of really good times too. And they were really good women time also. When that band, being constantly on the road and to leave that kind of pressure, it's like, okay, different face every night, let's give it a chance, man. So. I'm a sleepwalking cheater with a hat full of napalm. I'm a runaway son of the nuclear age. The world's forgotten boy, the one who searches and destroys. Somebody gotta help me, please. Somebody gotta save my soul. Baby, definitely for me.
When the thing blew up, I could tell. And I feel sure about this, that if we had tried to do something more, or if it would have been worse, it would have been mediocre musically, it would have been deranged, and somebody would have died. Mm-hmm. And so I could see that I had the opportunity to do something completely different with David Bowie, producing as a solo.
Bright and hollow sky, you know.
Back at it now, it was inevitable because of what I was doing was, you know, was going in that direction. Mm. We wrote it in Miami and rehearsed it in Ann Arbor.
Yeah.
It's Scott who persisted every couple of years trying to get it going. Okay.
You know, I've always wanted mostly to do it all these years because I have so many friends in Detroit that practically begged me, you know, oh, can we ever hear you guys again? Oh, we want it so bad, so bad. Mm. You know, to me, that's a big, big part of it.
Too. So it was kind of natural. I was looking. I was like, shit, isn't there anything else I could do? And I didn't know what else to do, so I decided to throw the door open. So that was it. And then it began then to snowball very quickly. I began to think about it immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And I was free enough so I could do it.
Mm.
Yeah, he was roofing and landscaping and no, I always played. I played, made a few bucks, never had a lot of money, but I always played. So I was probably poverty, not poverty level, but stock boy at Myers or Kmart level maybe, but
it's just the same people mostly going about it the same way mostly, but it's not the same. And interestingly enough, no two records have ever been remotely the same for this group.
You're a musician yourself, you know that
you
can't stop playing. If that's what you love, you're gonna do it till your wheels fall off.
The main thing is, like, you know, now that I got the last 3 years of this and got that record done, during this period has been it's not only because of this, but I finally got to the point when I go in front of the mirror in the morning as the musician that I am, as Iggy Pop, I smile and I say hi, and I'm real good with him, you know, and I feel like properly, like, all right. There's a plan you can have besides that. Your plan to make good music is to be prepared and be poised and be ready to take advantage of whatever comes.
Mm.
That we are.
I think the most rewarding is that we are here and that there's people that weren't born in the day and people that were, and they get to experience it and be there. And to me, that's rewarding.
No fun! No fun! No fun! God damn it, play no fun! Yeah! 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 No fun, my babe. No fun. Turn on the house lights! No fun! No fun to hang around feeling that same old way. No fun to hang around freaked out for another day. Yeah. Yeah.
fun, my babe, no fun.
Damn it, thank you.
Right. Okay, can you just, can you just
Yeah. Oh, cool. Oh, French. I remember.
Yeah, thank you.
Is this the real, is this French?
No, I think that's American.
This is French.
No, that's French. That's, isn't it?
I don't know.
No, it's American. It's French from the 60s. No, is it American?
Yeah, no, it's a French one.
It's French. Paris. This only existed in France. Oh, I remember they showed it to us.
Oh, yeah, it's a different thing.
Yeah, it's Vogue. Yeah. Vogue, it's French. Yeah,
it's a perfect thing. I want you here. Cool. Fire them up. And then I need a little head bridge. And I have to go to Iggy Pop Stooges. And I lay
right down in my face. Show machine. What are we doing? Pictures.
Oh. Now I wanna. I'm sorry, but of course that was supposed to see about there.
Be very short, but I think.
Everybody's serious but me. It occurs to me that
I'm Iggy Pop, and this is my life.
I don't feel good. Don't bother me.
One night out in L.A., I met a Mexican with a butchie girlfriend.
Are you being sinister, or is this some form of practical joke?
Most likely to succeed, ninth grade. Tenth grade formed Iguanas High School Rock Band.
Blossoms are falling. I'm sick of hearing the same demands.
Exterminate the roots. Something was in me and it had to come out. I started getting wild.
All right. Made me want to be a saint.
But I mean, I like
it. America, stop pushing. I know what I'm doing.
Do you have anything you'd like to say to America?
I would just like to say at this point that I'm a 24-hour, 7-day, 365-day a year.
Mystical visions and cosmic vibrations.
Resurface.
Exterminate the roots. Exterminate.
occurs to me that I am America. I am talking to myself.
Ambition.
America, this is the impression I get from looking
at
the television set.
To make better music.
Set. America is
live life in peace,
I'd
and then
get right down to the job.
Die. Not so easy to do.
I really gotta go now. see everybody. Hey, you fucking guys. Yes, there is a mound of trash covering the whole world. And that trash comes from America. And if America is a giant hamburger, I am the bun on that hamburger. I don't always want to have to think about AIDS. No health insurance. No fucking money. No education. Well, fuck it. Cause right now, I'm gonna sing my song. Life after Bush and Gorbachev. The wall is down, but something is lost. Turn on the news, it looks like a movie. It makes me want to sing Louie Louie. We'll be right back.